Let's talk now about the idea of experimental design and actual data collection. First, look at the learning objectives for this next few videos. First of all, understand the different sources of error that occur when measurements are made. One thing you need to understand is whenever you measure something, there's going to be error. It's just the way it is. There's going to be error. By understanding what the source of these errors are, you can help control it, help reduce this area, help keep yourself out of trouble. We want to be able to recognize the different types of experiments conducted, understand the importance of randomization in data collection, and utilize different sampling techniques in the data collection process. Now, let's first start with a discussion about just what is good research. What makes up or what constitutes good research? Good research, first and foremost, generates dependable data. Dependable data means that the data is reliable. It's been obtained via methods that are mathematically and scientifically sound. If the data is reliable, if it's obtained in appropriate ways, then you're going to help reduce the idea of bias, as an example. You will be able to generalize back to your population. We talked about that in earlier discussion, the idea that we take a sample, analyze the sample, and typically make an inference back or generalize back to the general population what's happening. If you have dependable data, then you will be able to make, or hopefully be able to make, that generalization back. Getting good, reliable, dependable data is extremely important in any type of data analysis project. Appropriate research ethics are absolutely paramount. The goal of any and all legitimate research should be that of determining to the best of your ability, and that's kind of important, the idea that this is to the best of your ability, because no matter what you do, there's going to be some mistakes made. Mistakes meaning error in data measurement. It could be what one person thinks of a mistake in terms of an analytical technique used. Another person may think, well, that's the right way to go. There's some gray area that we're working in here. This is not all that black and white. It should be determining to the best of your ability the true status of a particular topic of interest, not what we can make it appear to be. When you go out and collect data, you could spend months preparing, many more months collecting the data, many more months actually analyzing the data, and all of a sudden the result is not what you hoped for, not what you wanted. Well, guess what? That's the way it is. The results are the results. Just because you don't like them, that doesn't mean you go back and say, how can I change it now to get what I wanted? Well, that is where we run into all kinds of problems, and the idea of statistics and data analysis gets a bad name. I'm sure you've all heard someone say something like, what good are statistics? You can make them say whatever you want. Well, that's only true if you're unethical. If you do the research, you get the results, you don't like them, you go back and start changing data. You start changing techniques because you know this other technique, or at least think this other technique, is going to bring you the result you want. No, that's not good. That is an unethical approach. We need to personally set high ethical standards when we conduct data analysis. Set high standards when we collect the data. Set high standards when you complete the analysis. Set high standards when you report it. What happens, happens. That's just where the data led you. If you like it, great. If you don't, sorry. That's just the way it goes. One way we can help ensure that we have good data and that we have high ethical standards is to employ the scientific method. We can help reduce the probability of faulty research by maintaining the standards of the scientific method, which is number one, this is really important, folks, clearly define your purpose. If you can't state why you're doing this, then why are you doing it? You need to be able to clearly state your purpose. If you can't articulate it, if you can't write it down so that someone else can understand it, you shouldn't be going any further. You need to understand, or you need to know, why it is that you're doing this research. What is the purpose? You want to produce a detailed explanation of the research process. How was the sampling technique employed? What sampling technique was employed? How was the data gathered? What happened? What did you do when you had data that was unusual? Did you automatically throw it out, or did you investigate it? Did you throw any data? Was there any obvious errors in the data collection process? If you're looking at something to do with juveniles and you come up with a 600-pound 2-year-old, you know there's a problem. How many 600-pound 2-year-olds are running around? There's not. You may be able to go back to the individual medical record, that's where it came from, and realize it's just a typo and get the correct rate or weight. Or you may not. If you can't correct it, if you can't clearly correct it by going back to medical records, then that's grounds for tossing it out. Okay, but clearly, if that happens, clearly explain the process that you went through, anything unusual that happened, and what you did to correct it. Report limitations. Well, you know, you may be interested in everybody with type 1 diabetes on the planet. Well, it's going to be kind of hard to sample from that population. Your sample may only come from a particular hospital at a particular city. So it may be very difficult to make that general relation to that huge population. So state it. Just say in here that, you know, this is clearly a limitation. Although this sample we think is reasonably representative of people in this area and the lifestyles of the people in this area, it may or may not well generalize the people in other states and their lifestyles, or something to that effect. If there's clear limitations in your research, state it. Be up front with your reader. You're not trying to hide anything. Be up front with your reader. Justify your conclusions. Don't just say, well, I think yada, yada, yada. Say, I think yada, yada, yada because this is what the data said. And show what the data pointed to. Based on this in the data, this is the conclusion that came from. Justify why you're making these conclusions. Don't just reach into the thin air and grab conclusions out of the air that sound cool. If at all possible, we want to provide the raw data in an appendix. Now, this may not be possible. If you're working with medical research of some type, you can't necessarily always provide the information about the folks that you gather data about because it's personal data. You may be able to sanitize it by removing their name, record numbers, you know, identification numbers in the hospital. That may be acceptable, or the hospital may simply have rules that say that if you're going to collect and use the data from this hospital, it has to stay confidential, period, and it will not go in any type of report. Well, that's the way it is. If you have a client that you're working with, it's maybe Frito-Lay or Coca-Cola or some business, well, their data they may consider to be proprietary, and you can use it for the analysis, give us the results, but you're not going to publish the results with our data in it, you know, that sort of a thing. So it's not always possible to do, but if it is possible, then we do want to do it. Something that we really want to avoid is the idea of junk science. This is a serious problem, and it happens a lot. Junk science is the use of faulty scientific data, poor data collection, and or faulty analysis of otherwise good data. So we have bad data we're using to come to conclusions, or good data that we're using a faulty analysis on to come to bad conclusions. In a nutshell, that's what junk science is about. Junk science is sometimes the result of not knowing any better. Sometimes it's intentional. The media, various components of the media love to use junk science to instill that shock factor for a story. Politicians tend to use junk science to prove their point, and businesses to bolster their product and or attack a competitor's product. The use of junk science is very common, both intentionally and accidentally. The key here is we want to avoid junk science by following a good scientific method approach. That will help you avoid falling into junk science. You know, here's a common example of junk science. Wine. You hear quite often that red wine is good for you, so you should drink red wine. Well, based on that, then I think it'd be a good idea for every night before I go to bed, I'm going to get ripped on red wine. If I can polish 3 bottles a night, then I should be really healthy within a couple of months. Well, see, there is scientific research that suggests something in wine that is good for you in general, but not at extremes. That's the junk science part. Chocolate, every time you turn around, somebody's advertising something about chocolate. They found chocolate that's good for you. I don't know, it cures cancer, reduces heart problems. I don't know what the latest claim is. You know, maybe there is something in chocolate that's found in chocolate that really is good for you. That doesn't mean that chocolate's good for you. You know, you don't want to eat 3 pounds of chocolate a night. just because there's something in it that you think is good. See, that's kind of extreme, silly type examples, but I think it kind of illustrates well the idea of junk science. Something that's legitimate that's used in a ridiculous way. Okay, that's going to wrap up this particular section, and in the next video we're going to take a little time and discuss in more depth the sources of error.